Hey kids, remember SOAP? We've got it again, except now with curly braces. It's the OpenAPI specification. It's a standard programming language agnostic interface description for REST APIs. Jeff Hollan is here to show me how to create an Azure function from an OpenAPI definition and then use API management to secure it, transform it, maintain it, and monitor it today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, it's Azure Friday. I'm back with Jeff Hollan talking about Azure Functions. This time we're going to dig a little bit deeper and we're going to add in API management. You ready, sir?
Let's do it. And the first place I wanted to start with is our old friend, or maybe new friend for some of you, Swagger, or the OpenAPI definition. Mm-hmm. It might be a new concept to folks watching this, but I think the idea behind it is sound and something that I'm starting to see a lot of traction and questions around, which is almost before you start writing that first line of code, like you decide, I need an API. This is going to be some contract between whoever is calling this API, whether it's outside of my company, inside my team, inside my own app, and the thing it's calling. There's a contract there, which is the API. An OpenAPI definition is this open standard that lets you describe that as an artifact. So you're like, this is what the API contract is. You can publish it, you can consume it, you can understand without ever calling something, without seeing the code. Oh, okay, I understand the size and shape of this API. And so I wanted to talk some about that and how you can use that definition and that design pattern even when building serverless APIs with Azure Functions.
Okay, so let me see if I can understand this. I could write an API description for my brand new super company API. I could put it in a Word document. I could give it to you, except Word documents don't have any teeth. They're just Word documents. I can't really programmatically do anything with it other than to say, hey, you didn't follow the specification. This is one with actual teeth, and I can, once I have that, I can assert it, I can strongly type it, I can generate stuff off of it, I can generate documentation, I can do anything, because it ain't a Word document.
All of that, that's exactly it. And so I'll show you what this can look like today. There's a number of different tools that you can use to build an OpenAPI definition. One of my favorites is just using Azure API Management because they give you this little design experience right here where I've said, okay, I want an API. It's called the Azure Fridays API. Mm-hmm. And it's going to have two operations, a get message and a put message. And so I've defined the verb, I've defined the path here, you know, get message is going to be its last message. And then I've even able to come in here and say, hey, it's going to have like this query parameter, this is the response body that it's going to have. So I can describe all of these things. You know, here's an example of what this response will look like. I'm using this visual editor, but what it's actually generating for me behind the scenes is this open API definition, this Word doc that you would hand off or this Word doc you could share with anyone that lets me know, okay, what is the size and shape of the Azure Friday API? And as I mentioned, what's growing increasingly popular is this idea of design first APIs, meaning before I even start writing code, maybe I'm just going to come in here and describe what is the ideal contract, what is the ideal response type, what is the ideal request type. So I can describe all that here. When I'm ready to go, I could go ahead now and export this from API management. And here's our friend, this open API or Swagger definition. And you can choose your flavor. Do you like the one with curly braces with JSON, or do you like the one with tabs and spaces of YAML? Both have their own quirks. But I can open that up, and this is the document version, not very human readable at this point, but very much machine readable. And you'll see how this comes in handy in a bit. No, not too bad of like, okay, here's my message endpoint. It has a get. This is what it's doing. And here's the response that it's sending. So this is now my design first API.
And you would do this, you said design first, meaning like I have an idea and I'm not even going to write the code yet. I'm just going to talk about like, here's the outside of the house. We'll worry about how to organize the rooms and the internal details of this, but the structure looks like this.
Yes. Yep. And the idea being even too, like if this is the plans of the house, if this is the blueprint, it doesn't really matter if the thing that actually will perform the message get is an Azure function, if it's a web app, if it's a container in a Kubernetes cluster. My team could figure out what's the right thing to have there. But what doesn't change is this contract, the overall size and shape of the API. Let's lock on that first, and then we can implement it in whatever tool makes sense for us.
Cool.
So if I do choose, as I hope more and more folks might choose, hey, maybe Azure Functions is a good fit for the get message thing, or Azure Function is the right thing for put. There's a new capability that we've just released that integrates these serverless APIs with these OpenAPI definitions. So to show you that, I'll go ahead here in Visual Studio Code, and I'll say I want to create a brand new functions project. Now, I could use the CLI. If I'm not using VS Code, maybe I'm using Visual Studio, but here I'm going to just use Visual Studio Code. And I could choose any language I want. Let's go with C# for now, because I love C#. And here in the template screen at the very bottom, this is this new create some HTTP triggers using an OpenAPI definition as the scaffolding, as the kind of size and shape of this function app. So let's choose that here. It's going to ask us, hey, where is that OpenAPI definition? So go ahead and select the one we just exported from API Management. And what this tool is now doing, it's asking my namespace. Let's just keep the default namespace short. Stencil is the name of this project. What it's doing is it's using this tool, this open source tool called AutoREST, to generate for us an Azure Function app. So this is an Azure Function app. If I open up this thing, it has Azure Function attributes, like here's the function name. This is an HTTP trigger. But the cool thing here is this has built me a function API that matches the spec that I started with earlier in the API management portal.
Wow. And is that idiomatic, like C#? Is that a good looking bunch of code right there? Whenever I hear about auto-generating, where I took something small and generated a bunch of other stuff, how good did we get at doing this?
We tried to keep it pretty simple because, to your exact point, what is great C# for me might not necessarily be great C# for you. So there's a few things we did that are what we consider best practices in Azure Functions. By default, if I use another template, I might see these being static methods, which is fine. But here I'm going to pop in this constructor-based pattern, or I'm actually going to initialize my own logger, which is something we feel is a good flexible pattern and kind of sets you up success there. We've generated some of those models, like I have a request message and a response message that we've set up in ways that work well. But to your point, like we tried to keep this pretty simple so that if you have your own design pattern or maybe there's a universally accepted way, you're not too tied in with too much auto-generated code. It's just more or less set up when I push F5 here to run this function, does this have the size and shape of an app that I would expect?
Nice. Is it compliant? Does it do what it needs to do? And I can then plug in whatever I need to at this point.
Yep. And just to show that, and I know I almost did this, let's initialize this for VS Code, which is an extra step here that I'll add. That adds, maybe I'm not going to do this because VS Code, is this happy? Okay. Nope, it's not. I'm not going to worry about why. Okay. Size and shape thing. Yes. Yeah. And exactly that. So once I've gotten this up and running, maybe I replace this placeholder code with actual code that I'm going to be running. I can publish this into my subscription. And now this Azure function could back this API that I've defined here in API management. Now, there's a number of reasons that I actually might want to continue to use API management even after I publish the function. It's more than just this OpenAPI generating tool. It can actually provide for me a few additional valuable features. So if I have here in API management, in this case, this is pointing to an Azure function. So I've defined the API. In this case, I've actually published some code that does some actual work. And I want to use API management is the first thing it hits. So when someone calls my API, they hit API management. API management then routes it to my function. And why would I want that extra layer? Like why shouldn't I just tell people to call my function directly? What in the world would I want to bring in API management for? So a few things here. The first, you get this design tooling so that maybe today this POTH message is backed by an Azure function. Maybe a month from now you decide, actually, Azure Functions isn't working well for what we need in this environment. We need a bit more heavy compute. Maybe we need GPUs. We're going to move this over to Kubernetes. You don't have to tell any of your clients to go change any of their code. Nothing changes for them. They keep calling your API through API management. Maybe I just swap out the backend though. So that's one reason I might want API management.
So is API management in this case acting as a reverse proxy?
Yes. Yep. Which is one of the most useful patterns for API management is just acting as that reverse proxy to give you some added flexibility as you change your API. The other reason that I see a lot of value with using API management with Azure Functions, and I failed to mention this at the beginning, but one thing to note for those who might have looked at API management before, sometimes they're like, hey, some of these things are nice, but API management, how much does it cost? Like, is it super expensive? There are definitely some premium SKUs that are a little bit more expensive, but I am here using the consumption SKU of API management, which means I only pay when this thing is executed. I get like a million calls a month for free. So this, the costs are more or less negligible depending on the scale that you're running this thing on.
Wow.
So worth noting. Yeah.
I noticed that there was also output processing. Could I cache things there as well?
Yes. And that this was the last thing I wanted to highlight is these policies you can set. So one here, and we've even talked about this, I can say, you know what, as cool as it is that my function might be able to scale to the moon, I don't want somebody to get the URL to my function and call it so many times that they're going to create issues, either because some downstream service is going to have issues. I just want things to be secured. I can configure something like a rate limit where without touching my function code, I've told this thing, in this case, every 90 seconds, they have a number of calls per caller. They can only call this up to 5 times in 90 seconds. So I could demo this right now where if I call this thing the 6th time, it doesn't even hit my function. API management is just like, no, that's too many calls within the rate limit here that I've defined. And I could make this fit the one I want. Mm-hmm. And then your point two, I can add outbound processing. So I could say like, hey, I actually want you to cache that response or set some headers or do whatever else that it is to shortcut some of this processing so that I can add logic without having to touch my code and offload that more here to this API management layer and make it flexibly work with any of my APIs.
Interesting. This might be a little bit off the beaten path, but could I use API management as a front to other things like Azure Search Service or other APIs that are Azure specific? It would be a little weird to interject myself, but if I wanted that level of power to the shape of an API, could I use this to front an existing Azure API?
Yes. And it's not a completely uncommon thing to see. There's a few reasons we see folks doing exactly that. One of them is if you're doing anything in like the Power Platform world of Microsoft, like Power Apps, Microsoft Flow, Power BI, every single thing that's in API management can be consumed by Power Apps or Flow. And so I might choose to front a service that's not even mine, like to your point, maybe it's Azure Search, maybe it's some first party or third party API, because I'll have that surface in my Power portfolio. And now I can use it from my Power App, even if there's not an out of the box connector. The other one is, and I won't show it here because the consumption SKU doesn't have that. But if I use a higher SKU, you also get this development dashboard that will be a catalog of all of the APIs that your organization might use. And so in that world, it might make a ton of sense for your search API to show up alongside your customer API, even though one of them is your code and the other one is Azure Search, because as a developer, I don't really care which one's a fully managed service and which one's our own custom code. I just want that single catalog of all those APIs. So absolutely, there are folks who do exactly what you just asked.
Very cool. This sounds like a very, very powerful addition to the serverless catalog.
Yes, definitely. So if you're interested in design first APIs, that idea of let's sit down, design this thing first, those powerful new tools in Visual Studio Code will help jumpstart that experience, help you describe the shape of it, and then get the function that's customized with the routes and the query parameters and the models that you need. But then even on top of it, pairing API management with your Azure Functions is going to inject even additional value to give you some really slick and productive serverless APIs in the cloud.
Very cool. I am learning all about Azure Functions and API management today on Azure Friday. Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it. Watch more Azure Friday.